Hi, I'm Ellen, and I'm a graduate student in the Littleton Lab, here at the Picower Institute for Learning and Memory. I joined this lab because it's the perfect intersection of translational neuroscience and basic biology. I get to ask questions about biology that can have a real impact on human health and nervous systems. And I get to use the best model organism for biological research, the fruit fly. You may not have expected it, but Drosophila melanogaster is actually a powerful tool for understanding human health. Decades of genetic understanding have given us the power to perform genetic manipulations that aren't as easy or even possible in other genetic organisms. And fruit flies actually share a large number of their genes with us humans, making human disease research very straightforward. But don't let me just stand here and tell you about it. Come and see the lab. Welcome to the Littleton Lab Fly Room. I'm here with my colleague and fellow graduate student, Elizabeth. She's gonna start your tour here and show you around the lab and what we do.
Hi everyone, I'm Elizabeth, and when I joined the lab in 2017, I was really interested in the molecules that drive neuronal behavior and looking at neuronal diseases. In the Littleton lab, I was able to use the larval stage of Drosophila to really answer those sorts of questions and look at the synaptic structures that drive these behaviors.
In the fly room, we house thousands of flies where each vial contains a different genetic manipulation of the Drosophila genome. We study flies at both the larval stage and as adults. We can track specific mutations over many generations and can use this information to perform our experiments. Here, I am showing you a temperature-sensitive mutation in a protein that causes altered neural firing and epileptic-like seizures. At room temperature, the protein functions normally. Once we put the flies into this warm environment, we can see them start to fall to the bottom of the vial as they begin seizing. The warmer temperature reshapes the protein, now preventing it from executing its normal function. This sort of experiment can help us understand how different parts of the protein function in the neuron. What is even more interesting is that we breed these mutant flies with other fly lines, including a line expressing the related human protein, and we can see if these proteins can substitute in for one another to help mutant flies function normally again. This way, we can characterize the role of these human proteins in neuronal firing. Besides studying behavioral changes, we can also probe for the proteins with fluorescent tags and can electrically observe neuronal firing in the brain. We can also study these proteins where the nerves meet the muscles at the neuromuscular junctions, or NMJs. The fly nervous system contains large NMJs that innervate the body wall in a very consistent way, allowing us to follow the same individual neuron from the brain and into the muscle across each animal we use. We can then compare changes within a specified neural population when we genetically manipulate the fly. Here, I am showing you a larval body wall preparation that will set us up for these sorts of experiments. We use larval stage animals here because they are easy to dissect in a way that exposes muscles with their corresponding NMJs. We then either preserve this preparation for fluorescent staining, or we keep the dissection alive with a saline solution and move immediately to electrical stimulation and data acquisition. Using one of these live body wall preparations to measure changes in neuronal firing, we can observe how the neuron talks to the muscle. This happens at connections called synapses, which emit chemicals called neurotransmitters to transmit the electrical signals. Each little peak in this recording corresponds to single spontaneous neurotransmitter-filled synaptic vesicles being released into the synapse. Researchers can also carefully attach an electrode to this dissection, allowing them to stimulate the nerves and record a response in the muscle. We can represent synaptic changes based on sensory activity, such as those required for learning and memory, by using this stimulation. We can also do live imaging on the spinning disc confocal microscope to track NMJ changes over larval development. This is done by expressing fluorescent tags on synaptic proteins of interest, and we can image through the body wall over multiple days while keeping the animal completely intact. Here is an example of a fluorescent tag that allows us to study calcium oscillations at the NMJ. Each flash corresponds to an electrical event from one neuron stimulating an influx of calcium, which then activates this green fluorescent calcium reporter. Using this fluorescent sensor, our lab has pioneered a technique to map synaptic release strength with single release site precision, showing us how synaptic connections can differ.
Thanks so much for joining Elizabeth and I for this tour of the Littleton Lab and learning a little bit more about flies and how they can teach us about the brain. Bye!